on the cloud. All right, hello. I'm very happy to see everybody. Hotep, we say, in the ancient African tradition. We are very pleased and honored to be able to see all of our people who have been with us from the beginning. This is the Malefic Kete Asante Institute's lecture programs. These programs reach people in Africa and Europe, as well as South America and the United States of America and other places as well in the Caribbean. So we're delighted, we're honored to be able to see you and to have this meeting today. There are many things to talk about. We can talk, for example, certainly about what's going on in the European world. We just have to be careful that we don't get wrapped up into the ethnic arguments of Europe. Europe has brought the world in the past two international European wars. One in 1918, and another one in the 19th, actually late 30s, 40, 41, 42, and so forth. And it seems now that the Europeans are exhibiting, once again, through the Russian invasion of Ukraine, the same doublespeak that is always used when a major dominant power seeks to destroy weaker nations or to impose their will on other people. And this is what's happening. Of course, the justifications given always for war and for fighting other people are basically based on the same principles, that either you have an attempt at hegemony, and that is when one people believe that they have a right to take over other people. The other one is about land. It's a question of land. It's a question of, as the Germans used to say, Lebensraum. It's a question of living space, living room, a room space to live in. Another one is, of course, the idea of religion, that one's religion is different. And so I need to impose on you my God so that you can accept my God and be saved. Another one is the idea of what I call the racial ladder. That is that you are an inferior people. And because you are an inferior people, I have the right to impose my will on you in order to dominate you. These are the principal reasons for warfare and invasions, but they're not the only reasons. I mean, people have excuses. They want to expand their armies. They want to control the seaports. They want to ensure that they're able to get their grain or whatever their produce is out of their countries into the ocean so they can trade and make money from other nations. So these are some of the main reasons that we see battles. Now our responsibility, and I think that our responsibility as Africans has to be one that we ensure that we do not have, we do not get engaged in a situation where we allow European people to dictate the future of the world by dominating the discussion of whether or not there should be human existence or not. That's when you think about it, where you have two European nations that frightened the rest of the world into thinking that, hey, you know, we can control the destiny of the entire earth, 7 billion people. That's something that we have to be very, very wise about, and not get caught up in this fraternal or sibling, I should say, sibling war between people who relatively are the same people. I mean, the Ukrainians and the Russians have similar histories. In fact, they have similar, not just similar histories, but they also have similar policies, and they have followed similar guidelines and in terms of domination of other people. I mean, right now we know that the Roma people, the people that are called gypsies, are also suffering in Ukraine, and they're suffering in Poland when they have tried to leave Ukraine to go to Poland and other countries. The Polish people accept the Ukrainians, but they don't accept the Roma. And they have had difficulty accepting Africans who are studying or working or living in Ukraine, adding to Ukraine's power and so forth. So there are many issues that we need to sort out and be very careful as African people. Many African nations, of course, depend on Ukraine for wheat. But the question about the dependence on Ukraine for wheat ought to be a question where we say, why do we eat wheat anyway in Africa? Since that's not a staple of Africa. If anything, we ought to be growing enough cassava, enough yams in Africa, or teff from Ethiopia, enough grain from Africa to feed the African continent. But the reliance on wheat is evidence of a vestige of the occupation, the colonial occupation of Africa. When the Europeans were colonizing Africa, they brought with them their type of food, their type of clothes, their names, their gods, and all that. That all came with them. And wheat is one of those things that when you read that, wow, I mean, 80% of the wheat for certain countries in Africa, 80% of their wheat comes from Ukraine. And you have to say, why is this? Why the reliance and the dependence on Ukraine when we have, why the reliance on Ukraine and the reliance on Russia or reliance on anybody else? When we have enough, when we know we have enough land and enough capability to have our own possibilities in Africa, I mean, and our own wheat and all that kind of stuff. So these are the questions that really we have to look at, and we have to ask ourselves, why is it that Africa is dependent, always it seems, on outside forces and outside influences for our own salvation? And we don't have to do that. But anyway, that's another story. We'll talk deeper about that. We'll talk about the situation, certainly in Sudan at some point, because that's an ongoing situation in Africa. We have ongoing situations here with the killing of Black people in my old hometown of Buffalo. I lived in Buffalo for many years, and I know that situation very well in Buffalo. But to have somebody drive 3 hours just to kill Black people, you know, is a scary thing when you realize that in Buffalo itself, there are people who are really also scared of Black people. So everywhere we look, we're living in a world in which we have to be very careful and be very mindful that there are people who do not like our presence. And they don't like our presence, not because we are terrible people, but because we're good people, and because we are also people who are very successful. I always think that part of the reason that people attack us may very well be an inferiority complex that we rarely hear people talk about when we talk about white people, because you ask, why do people hate African people so much? I mean, we haven't done anything like this. I mean, we don't do things like this. We don't have this harbor this sense of hatred in the same way. In fact, our problem is that we shoot each other. And that's a problem of self-hatred on our part. So it's a complicated matrix that we are dealing with. And I think we just have to be very, very careful and understand deeply that our situation as African people must be people that are doing the right thing in the interest of humanity. So I'm going to introduce our speaker, who up until last year, I went by the name of Dr. Aaron Smith. He is actually Dr. Jabali Ade, A-D-E, Dr. Jabali Ade. And Dr. Jabali, J-A-B-A-L-I, Dr. Jabali Ade is one of the outstanding young scholars we have in Philadelphia. He is an assistant professor at Temple University. And in addition to that, he is a published scholar with several articles. He is also a publisher of many book reviews. He is engaged in publishing right now through the University of Mississippi, a book on Afrocentric futurism or Afrocentricity in futurism. He is known as the rapping professor at Temple University, and his classes are some of the largest elective classes that we have at Temple. He doesn't have to advertise his classes. Students tend to flock to his classes, and one of the largest classes at Temple is a class, 250 students, where students just come out to see him. So he's an amazing young man, highly gifted, and also very focused on an Afrocentric orientation to knowledge. And he also has been a leader. When he was in university, he was a leader among students. He's been an athlete as a track star. We tend to have track stars. I think Dr. Nehusi, one of her faculty members, was a track star in Guyana. So Dr. Jabali Ade is also a man who's deeply knowledgeable of tradition, religions, the particular of the United States religious impact and influence. He's loved and appreciated by many people in Philadelphia. So we're really happy to have Dr. Ade to talk to us today about anything he wants. I'm always saying to him that, you know, any subject that he wants to talk about, he always does a great job, but I think today he's talking about Tupac. All right, Dr. Ade.
Greetings, good people. After an introduction like that, I better get to work. How's everybody doing? It's an honor, a privilege, and a pleasure just to see your faces or just to see your names and just to imagine you on the other side of the screen. I'm going to jump right into it and share my screen. One of the things I thought to myself was, before I reconcile Tupac Shakur with today's politics, I need to at least give some context and some understanding as to why he would be a relevant subject of study. So I'm going to start here. This is a song called Brenda's Got a Baby. I'm going to make sure I can see the video feed as well. There I go. And I can see you all at the same time. Okay. So this is going to be one minute, 50 seconds, but I want you to listen to the interconnectivity of community that's emphasized in the first two lines of the song and some of the subject matter that I haven't heard in any genre of music in my lifetime, and at least spelled out this directly. Just have a listen.
I hear Brenda's got a baby, but Brenda's barely got a brain. A damn shame, the girl can hardly spell her name.
That's not our problem, that's up to Brenda's family.
Well, let me show you how it affects our whole community. Now, Brenda really never knew her moms, and her dad was a junkie putting death into his arms. It's sad, cause I bet Brenda doesn't even know. Just cause you're in the ghetto doesn't mean you can't grow. But oh, that's a book, my own revelation. Do whatever it takes to resist the temptation. Brenda got herself a boyfriend. Her boyfriend was a cousin, now let's watch the joy. And she tried to hide her pregnancy from a family who really didn't care to see or give a damn if she went out and had a church of kids. As long as when the check came, they got first dibs. Now Brenda's belly's getting bigger, but no one seems to notice any change in her figure. She's 12 years older, she's having a baby, in love with the molester who's sexing her crazy. And yet, and also thinks that he'll be with her forever, and dreams of a world with the two of them are together. Whatever, he left there and she had the baby solo. She had it on the bathroom floor and didn't know, so she didn't know what to throw away and what to keep. She wrapped the baby up and threw him in a trash heap. I guess she thought she'd get away, wouldn't hear the cries. She didn't realize how much the little baby had her eyes. Now the baby's in a trash heap bawling. Mama can't help her, but it hurts to hear her calling. Brenda wants to run away. Mama say you're making me lose pay, and social work is here every day. Now Brenda's gotta make her own way. Can't go to a family, they won't let her stay. No money, no babysitter, she couldn't keep a job. She tried to sell crack but end up getting robbed. So now what's next? It ain't nothing left to sell. So she sees sex as a way of leaving hell. It's paying the rent, so she really can't complain. Prostitute fam, swing. And Brenda's her name, she's gotta pay.
So there's reaction videos that are popular nowadays. And in some of these reaction videos, you'll see white men 40 years old listening to the songs like this for the first time and being brought to tears. Because a lot of times, generationally, we've been so colonized that we listen to the impression of a different generation from our enemies and oppressors more than we do primary sources. So oftentimes people will listen to what some white people said about Tupac who didn't like Tupac, who were also part of COINTELPRO, and then they'll turn around and talk about rap music. And I say, you know, if you were around during the 50s and the 60s and the 70s, how dare you ever think that you're going to get the truth about your children from those who didn't even give the truth about you? So I think it's important for us to take this kind of time to reflect, you know, in context, in an Afrocentric context, so that we could talk amongst ourselves about ourselves in our own language. And I was just taking a couple notes, and I saw drug abuse and incest and molestation and child services and teen pregnancy. And I said, what song do you know that covered that gamut of subject matter? See, I need people to understand why. Because people say, why are you watching him? Why are you following him? Why are you studying him? Because I don't know anybody else that did it. I love Gil Scott-Heron. I love Marvin Gaye. But there were some subjects in that song just then without a hook in less than 2 minutes that I said, this is why. People want to put it in context. This is some of the reasons and some of the emotions that evoked. Because I know a lot of people that grew up just hearing things like gangster rap, they didn't get this side of Tupac Shakur. They only got the other side. There's a New York Times interview that was done. The title is Baby Saved from Compactor. Because this was an actual story in 1991. James McKinley Jr. wrote an article for the New York Times that inspired this song by Tupac Shakur. Baby Saved from Compactor, where mother, 12, says she put him. So this is truly based on a true story. Baby Saved from Compactor, New York Times article. You can, and when Chuck D said that hip hop is our CNN, these are the kind of things that he was referring to. So moving on. Just to give it some context before I get started with the commentary. This is another song called Words of Wisdom, right? And I'm just going to play it for a little while and let you hear some of the political leanings of Tupac Shakur. First album, Tupacalypse Now. We're talking about 1991.
This is for the masses, the lower classes. When you left out, jobs were given better living, but we were capped out. Made to feel inferior, but we're superior. Break the chains on our brains that made us fear. Pledge allegiance to a flag that neglects us. Honor a man that refused to respect us. Emancipation proclamation, please. Lincoln just said that to save the nation. These are lies that we've all accepted. Say no to drugs, but the government's kept it.
So Dr. Asante in his introduction was talking about the inferiority complex. And there are a lot of people that don't talk about that complex. But what I thought was ironic, right? The ancestors speaking and making these connections is Tupac talked about this inferiority complex. And not only did scholars not talk about it, musicians didn't talk about it, politicians didn't talk about it. But here we have a young man who recognized the connection between colonial oppression and insecurity in the spirit of Francis Quest Wesley. Like, what's wrong with somebody who feels as though they need to put somebody else, made to feel inferior, but we're superior, break the chains on our brains that made us fear you, pledge allegiance to a flag that neglects us, and honor a man who refuses to respect us. Emancipation Proclamation, please. Lincoln just said that to save the nation. This isn't being taught in school. This isn't being taught in school now, unless you're, you know, part of that temple circle of scholars, or you've received some Afrocentric information, right? So this is why it's so imperative and important to come in and intercede between the generations and distort what was done by the elders and the ancestors, but also distort the potential and promise of the youth. See, they say that the elders are the steering and the brakes, and we as the young people are the gas. And if you want to destroy the alignment and the direction and the destiny and purpose of a vehicle, said vehicle being African people and destination being liberation, then disconnect the gas from the steering and the steering from the brakes. And that's what we see being done today. I don't know what's wrong with these young people. Oh, you don't? It's the same thing that was wrong with you if you let them tell it. Let me go ahead and keep on going. I only got 40 minutes. There's a song called Trapped. I'm just going to show the lyrics in this one. This is my last lyrical example. And the song says, you can't keep the black man down. They got me trapped. And he talks about, you know, mass incarceration. And the second verse, I'm going to bring you right here. They got me trapped, can barely walk the city streets without a cop harassing me, searching me, then asking my identity. Hands up, throw me up against the wall, didn't do a thing at all, telling you one day these suckers gotta fall. Cuffed up, throw me on the concrete, coppers tried to kill me, but they didn't know this was the wrong street. Bang, bang, count another casualty, but it's a cop who shot for his brutality. Who do you blame? It's a shame because the man slain, he got caught in the chains of his own game. How can I feel guilty after all the things they did to me? Sweated me, hunted me, trapped in my own community. One day I'm gonna bust. Blow up on this society. Now make the connection between the frustration and the inequality in the nation in these next two lines. One day I'm gonna bust, blow up on this society. We're talking about 1991, here we are in 2022, where it looks like the generation has already imploded, exploded, and is busted from frustration. But he was given a prophetic warning that if this inequality, if this brutality persists, one day I'm gonna bust and blow up on this society. But why would you blow up? Why would you be frustrated, Tupac? Why did you lie to me? I couldn't find a trace of equality. I'm right here. Work me like a slave Work me like a slave while they laid back. Homie, don't play that. This time I make them suffer the payback. So people say, what's going on, you know, in 2022? I said, people got tired. If one more cop harasses me, I just might go psycho. Tired of being trapped in, Malcolm talked about this, a vicious cycle of apathy, disease, and death. And Tupac said, I'm tired of being trapped in this vicious cycle. So a lot of times what we look at as wayward is simply exhaustion. I'm going to keep the party going. This is Afeni Shakur detailing the transformation of Tupac after being harassed and brutalized by the police for jaywalking.
When his first record was appearing on MTV, Tupac was beaten in the head very badly.
I called this press conference to announce that I have filed a $10 million claim against two Oakland police officers and the city of Oakland on behalf of Tupac.
The police officer stopped me on the sidewalk and asked to see my ID. They sweated me about my name. They were charging me with jaywalking. The officers said, you are not above the law. You have to learn your place. Put my hand out to get the citation. Next thing I know, my face was being buried into the concrete and I was laying face down in the gutter, waking up from being unconscious in cuffs with blood on my face, and I'm going to jail for resisting arrest.
That shit is traumatic, but that was a rite of passage. He come from a family where relatives were killed by the police.
Think about it, if you stop in the streets and you show your ID and you still getting sweated because of your name, my name makes me a criminal. It's about me being a young black male and I was lynched in broad daylight and then taken to jail for that.
So people always ask, and they don't want to make the connections. Until we can start to do a comparative analysis and connect the dots between the promiscuity that we see in some of our young sisters after they're violated, and when we see some of the so-called monsters in society, they'll talk about R. Kelly, but they won't talk about the fact that R. Kelly himself talks about being molested by a family member, right? Like if you don't want to connect the dots and you just want to throw somebody away and act as though you can prune a problem, then you don't make the proper analysis. Because I see the connection between the overcompensation of many of the black males in society that I do in some of the promiscuity that I see in my young sisters when they're abused, when they're violated. See, once this happens to somebody, once your manhood is stripped, once you are not a sovereign human being and you're denigrated and brutalized, there is some overcompensation that takes place and there's misplaced aggression that takes place. And you see people smoking, drinking, beating on sisters, having an overcompensated persona of a thug mentality. So you got to understand that the only type of rape is not sexual. There's other ways to strip some people of their humanity. There's other ways to violate people. And we live in a society where there's very little compassion for black men in this regard. So all kind of manner of evil, even the sexual type of violations that happen in prison, that people just don't pay the same attention to it. But in order to understand the language that they're speaking and the life that they're living and the potential that they can possibly give to the African liberation process, we have to recognize the pain first. I'm doing it in 40 minutes. So this is Tupac Shakur talking about, since Doc gave that beautiful introduction and talked about, you know, how I'm now known also as Jabali Ade. This is just a snippet of Tupac talking about how he used to run from his name and not wanting what he calls in the first portion of this audio, that bright light, right? He was afraid of that bright light, but then he became more comfortable with his name and the African connections. Listen to this.
You know, what's your name, Joe? I didn't want that bright star within me, you know, but now I embrace it. Because it gives you character, you know? Every time I say, what is your name? Tupac. I have to say, what does it mean? You know what I'm saying? Why is that name? And it's good. It gives me a chance to express myself and express what I'm about and what I'm going to do. With a name like Joe, who cares what it means? You know what I'm saying? It means nothing. Joe Schmo, you know what I'm saying? So it comes, what it does actually is liberate you and lets everybody know that you're breaking those chains that this whole society has put on you when you came here. They gave you a wrong religion, your wrong name, wrong, you know, switched everything around and put you in a society. So basically, I think that I'm not trying to put anybody down. And if your name is Joe, I'm sorry. But,
Or if it was Joe.
Yeah, if it was Joe. But on the strength, it should shock you. It should make you feel depressed. And it should make you feel bad inside walking around with some other person's name. You need to drop that and liberate yourself and really pick your name up. Because they told you your name was stupid when you came here. That's a dumb sounding name. You know what I'm saying? And so now you, okay, Joe, Jay, you know. So pick it up. You know what I'm saying? It's about that time. It's not all about just having an African name, because I met this sister, you know, she said, my name is, you know, Jody, but I want an African name, you know, because it's the end thing now to be positive. But don't just get an African name, get an African brain, you know what I'm saying?
Okay, I'm gonna keep going. I could start right there and then do it all over. Don't just get an African name, get an African brain. When you got here, you know, they told you that your name was dumb and there's a bright man. Because, see, people ask. I know, you know, you got to meet people where they are. And I know there's some people that don't know that Tupac was talking like he worked in the department. But I need to make sure that we're brought up to speed before I really, you know, start the conversation. I'm going to go ahead into these slides at this point. Don't just get an African name, get an African brain. So somebody as profound and prophetic, you know, needs to be reconciled with the current generation of politics. First, I do something called Who's in the Room, right? Tupac Shakur, born 1971. 1990s popularity, primarily movies, music, right? Afeni Shakur. One of the most beautiful things that I always thought, if you ever heard the song Dear Mama, was this divinity of femininity that came with an assignment and not simply a momentary action. Like when Tupac says, even as a crack fiend mama, you always was a black queen mama. This ability to see people beyond their circumstances or their actions in the moment is something that we wrestle with just within our own families and sometimes in ourselves. Sometimes we'll beat ourselves up for something that we did years ago or somebody we let into our lives that we shouldn't have years ago. And we can't even live in the moment and think about the future to such an extent that so Tupac's ability to see past circumstance and understand the divinity of femininity was very powerful. He talks often about, you know, the role that his mother and women played in his life. And just the fact that as a Black Panther, after the Panther 21 case began, and her other 20 comrades, she elected to be her own counsel. Can you imagine being accused of wanting to bomb the botanical gardens and having all manner of evil in the form of COINTELPRO and all the press coalescing to destroy you for something that you know you did not do? And you with a child inside of you say, I feel so confident. I didn't pass the bar. I didn't take the LSATs. I didn't go to law school, but I feel so confident in truth and my ability to reason and have logic that I'm not only going to represent myself, but I'm going to represent. She was one of the 21 Panthers arrested and charged with conspiracy to carry out bombings in public places. A pregnant Shakur represented herself and was acquitted of all 156 charges. Somebody in here might make documentaries, do blogs, or might one day have a plan to make a movie. I got no problem with the Django Unchained and everything else, but somebody needs to make the Frederick Douglass movie. Somebody needs to make the Afeni Shakur movie, because we need sisters and brothers to understand their potential. This is a phenomenal story of resistance against colonization, imperialism, and infiltration. People need to know, what did you say? What gave you the courage? What was the strategy? Because we have to work together. I hear people all the time, you know, negate other forms of struggle. And I have to remind them that Geronimo Pratt was not freed by his comrades the way that Asada was freed by Matulu and others. Geronimo Pratt was freed by a member of Kappa Alpha Psi, shout out to Michael Kors, right? Named Johnny Cochran. So when you do all the protesting in the street and the guerrilla warfare and you fighting the military and everything else, and they finally lock you up for using that same military might for the liberation of your people, like Malcolm said, they send you to Korea and fight and Vietnam and fight. But when these two-legged dogs, six, four-legged dogs on your grandmother, he said, you can't. See, when you finally wake up and you say, oh, I can use this, like they did in Tulsa, Oklahoma, when they took the high road and prevented other people from getting killed and made it less of a massacre than it would have been during the uprising, right? So then they turn on you. And those same people that we, like Dr. Sandy was saying, the sibling rivalry. You want to talk about who's in Jack in jail, and they want to talk about who's studying a sar in a set. They want to talk about who's in a Greek fraternity, and they want to talk about who's wearing a dashiki, knowing that y'all gonna need each other when these devils coming for y'all, all y'all at the same time. And you want to talk about how you Jamaican, you Igbo, when you get pulled over, I'm not even gonna say what you are. Tupac said it enough. I gotta see somebody in the chat. I'll admit them. But who's in the room? Let's just Huey P. Newton. I just want to meet people where they are. Founder of the Black Panther Party, member of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated, in conjunction with Bobby Steele, founder of the Black Panther Party. And I talk often about Bobby Hutton and the ways in which the environment of a Bobby Hutton was so different than for a Bobby Shmurda, who is a rapper from New York City, who talked about selling crack since the fifth grade and was recently convicted of some crimes along with some other people who are currently doing, you know, 10, 20, 30, and 40 years in prison, and how they use their music to oftentimes confess to crimes on record. And I say the primary difference between Bobby Hutton and Bobby Shmurda, it wasn't their desire to jump off the porch and be independent and feel themselves and sow their oats. That's just what young people do at that level. It's the environment that was available. See, when Bobby Hutton was ready to fight and make a name for himself, there was a structure. There were institutions. There were what they call OGs, older people, elders, or in Philadelphia, old heads, you know, that were able to take that gas, like I said, and be the steering and the brakes. So when you remove, you know, the originators of the gangs, right, and the community engagement and the organizational, you know, components, and you just leave the violence, you know, and you bring more guns in, then you are left with that kind of situation. I'll make sure I mute whoever's. If anybody can see, then just let me know and I'll shout them out. I see one and I'll mute that. Okay, thank you. Bobby Seale, co-founder of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. And I often talk about the Black Panthers going from shootouts to voter registration drives. Because oftentimes we want to look at people like baseball cards. We want to talk about Malcolm when he didn't want to hear anything from anybody. And he was more radical and fanatical. But they don't want the Malcolm that said, I'm willing to work with anybody who's willing to work with us. Because if you take that same approach that Malcolm ended up taking, they'll call you all kind of names. Right? I was reading an amazing book, Being Human Being, right? Dr. Malefiquete Asante and Dr. Nadav, and talks about, you know, dismantling this racial hierarchy, right? And people will accuse you of not wanting to hold on to your victimhood and not wanting to adhere solely to the racial paradigm that never served us a lick, because they're stuck in a moment where they would prefer
a savvy, fiery rhetorician than one who builds institutions. I can send my child to Tuskegee today, but I can't, let me not make y'all, because y'all was taught not to like Booker T, and that's why we can't get a school going now. So I'm saying beneficial extraction, we need to take what's good in every situation. If one person can build a school, we need to figure out what he did to build a school. The fact there's not active think tank components in place right now to figure out exactly how they were not only making the bricks and somebody should just Google Tuskegee laboratories and see those young black brothers and see them people, you know, with the test tubes and everything, and then look at the quality of the bricks, and then you ask yourself, why was I given so much negative propaganda? The same way you were given a negative propaganda about these modern day prophets, these gangster rappers, the CNN of the same thing was used. There's a piece called John Potash did something called The War on Tupac Shakur and Black Leaders. It makes a connection between the US organization and the Black Panther Party when Bunchy Carter was killed. And they said they called their operation an East Coast, West Coast rivalry. East Coast, West Coast, the same exact thing they said in the 90s when Tupac Shakur was having a dispute with Biggie, and the same ways that they exaggerated minor and existing conflicts, which is in the documentation for COINTELPRO, the same thing they did in the 60s, they did in the 90s. But if you could sever the tie, if you could sever the communication lines, and you could put us at odds with each other, and you could just have the young people saying the old people washed up, they too tired, they don't know anything, and you got the old people saying, oh, the young people just crazy, and they don't listen to anything. If you could just get in. See, the worst thing that can happen, I know there's nobody who's ever been a cheater in this room because y'all are Afrocentric, so you don't have any issues with temptation and infidelity. But if you know a cheater, the worst thing that can happen is that his main partner and his side partner are in the same place and start comparing notes. You got to make it plain for some people, right? He said, oh, they both at this party. Maybe I should leave, right? Because if they start talking to each other directly, they're going to realize that somebody that was in between us wasn't just giving us the same gifts and promised to marry us both. Let me go ahead and keep it going before somebody get in trouble. Okay, Matula Shakur, I shouted him out before, not Tupac's biological father, but Tupac's primary father figure, right? Acupuncturist, New African Panthers, and known for, you know, his service to the community and also his affiliation with Asada Shakur. I'll leave that there. You know, people have open cases. J. Edgar Hoover. Right, we have 40 to 50 years of taxpayer money. Just like when you watch movies about black people working for white people, you have to also understand that the tax dollars that were paid to the same government that would spend that money on fire trucks and fire hoses to spray us and dogs to bite us and then give it to other government institutions to infiltrate, dismantle, and like the documentation says, to neutralize us. So when we talk about reparations, they talk about hours worked. They don't talk about physical trauma, and they don't talk about separation. You take somebody's child, you might owe them millions of dollars. You know, you whip somebody's back. They call it checkering, right? Vertical. You might owe somebody millions of dollars, right? If you violate somebody physically, you might owe them millions of dollars. So when they give you that them numbers, 14 trillion, and they just calculate an hour's work, they're not even talking about convict leasing and the other 80 years after the Emancipation Proclamation. They're not talking about the lynchings during Jim Crow. They're not talking about the redlining and the real estate and the no money down homes that all these white people got. In some cases, 70,000 homes was given, right? They're not talking about the head right system where 50 acres of land was given to white people just for making the trip, right? As a minimum. See, the reason why they can't face the truth is because they know, like shout out to Randall Robinson in the book, The Debt, there is no way to repay what has been stolen. So when sometimes we're engaging with people who, even if they know the answer, they're going to work harder to deny the reality of said truth. So Asada Shakur, what's interesting about Asada Shakur is a lot of times in Tupac's stories, he talks about things like being on the turnpike and getting pulled over by a state trooper and a cop getting shot. Tupac, in songs like Violent and Soldier Story on his first album, talks about being in prison and having the bigger brother break the other brother out of prison. See, Tupac, in all of his so-called gangsterism, was often telling the tales of the Black Liberation Army, talking about people like Asada Shakur. And a lot of times it's ironic because we hear so much about gender and gender roles and toxic masculinity. Here we have a young man finding his strength, finding his most ferocious militancy in his godmother or, you know, auntie, as they say, right? So a lot of what you hear in Tupac Shakur's music that was used to separate the elders from the young people is just him recounting his inspiration of what actually happened in his family. That's the gangster right there. they make you despise the gangster. Let me just go ahead. I know I only got like 15 minutes, right? And I don't know what the bounty is right now. I thought last I checked, I thought it was 2 million. And Tupac said, you got money for wars, but can't feed the poor. If you got $2 million just to bring one sister back, but they tell you to get over it, and it was a long time ago. Okay. Okay. So what's Pac got to do with it? So people say that's really deep and that's like a global analysis, but what about things we hear about every day? So I said, let me bring it all the way down and meet people where they are and talk about something that you might've heard a lot about even if you tried to avoid it. Because if you were watching the Oscars or you saw some of the news from the Oscars, then you might've saw something with Will Smith and Chris Rock. And I wanted to give a practical application, you know, with some current events, right? So I wanted to give just for like 5 minutes, you know, maybe 8 minutes, a serious look at Tupac and pain, because what happened with Will Smith and Chris Rock connects directly, not only because Jada, you know, was friends with Tupac Shakur and they went to the Baltimore Performing School of Arts and everything like that. This Tupac and Jada, you know, doing one of those videos that you make at the carnival. I'll just give you like 20 seconds.
Let's put this coat back, please. She said no. You go to school and learn for a fashion show.
So that is Will Smith's song playing when a young Jada and Tupac are at a carnival as friends. So you see how the ancestors work. People, the elders used to say God has a sense of humor, right? And if you want to make God laugh, just tell him your plans, right? So just imagine you sitting there listening to this rapper, you know, and then one day you end up marrying said rapper. Oh, I'm just going to keep it going because, you know, this is a rabbit hole. But there was a story about insecure Will Smith's jealousy over Jada Pinkett's love for Tupac and a deep regret. And Will Smith confessed that he was deeply insecure over his wife Jada's complex relationship with Tupac, which ended on bad terms, right? So they were friends at the Baltimore School of Performing Arts. This is Tupac talking about Jada for like a few seconds.
Jada Pinkett. Jada is my heart. You know what I mean? She will be my friend for my whole life.
Well, maybe I'll be down to scoop you up later in life. You ain't all shriveled up.
We'll be all together.
Be like Ozzie Davis and Ruby Dee.
Vic, you know you always got a place in my heart.
She can have my one heart, my liver, my lungs, my kidneys, my blood, marrow, all of that. Keep your head
up. Okay. So there was a situation where the daughter was writing a letter to Tupac, you know, posthumously, and saying that, you know, that she knows he's alive and that the daughter wishes he was here, and the daughter was not even alive when Tupac was killed. So a lot of times we talk about politics, and I like to make it plain and say the politics for our community is primarily local politics and the politics of self, family, and community. I'm gonna say that again. People say, oh, do you see what Trump tweeted at 3 o'clock? And I say, have you talked to your brother in the last 3 years that you estranged from because of something that he said happened 10 years ago that you can't even remember? I think that's more important. I think you'd be better off calling a family member that you haven't talked to in 3 to 10 to 20 years than you would about worrying what Donald Trump said, right? So the politics that I'm talking about today is the type of politics that can disrupt that foundation. When we see a Saw and a Set, when we hear the story, I always say, you know, the whole idea of somebody being cut up and pieces of them being separated and that divine feminine putting that person back together. And I say this ritual is repeated daily in powerful Afrocentric Black households with balance and mutual cooperation for complementary opposites and respect. Every day I go out, I will get cut down, I will be followed, I might be harassed, I might be counted as less than, but there is a woman with a power, a divine femininity that can every day, like Humpty Dumpty, put me back together and stitch me back up and empower me again to go back out and face that world. And we repeat these cycles till we can repeat this and produce more life. See, this is the type of politics that we need to talk about and understand. How did we get on the wrong footing? How did we lose communication with one another? How did you start looking at me like a paycheck and I started looking at you like a woman of the night? Where did we lose ourselves and our purpose and our way? These are the type of politics that we want to understand so we don't pass on the most negative, toxic, you know, portions and stagnated portions of ourselves to the next generation. This young lady should not be part of that conversation. There's something that they used to say called grown folks business and what a child should do when dealing with grown folks business. And I would say that this is grown folks business that a child has no business being a part of. But we all can do better, right? I'm not saying anybody's perfect. So this is Tupac Shakur commenting in 1992 on a man that would become the president over a decade plus later.
This world is such a, and when I say this world, I mean it. I don't mean in an ideal sense. I mean in every day, every little thing you do. It's such a, gimme, gimme, gimme. everybody back off. You know, everybody's like, you taught that from school, everywhere, big business. If you want to be successful, you want to be like Trump, gimme, 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 push, 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 step, 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 crush, crush, crush. That's how it all is. And it's like, nobody ever stopped. Just, you know, I feel like instead of us just being like, slavery's bad, slavery's there, bad whitey, bad whitey. I mean, all right, let's stop that. And everybody's smart enough to know that, I mean, we've been slighted and we want ours. And I don't mean by like ours, 40 acres and a mule, because we're past that. But we need help. I mean, for us to be on our own 2 feet, us meaning youth or us meaning black people, whatever you want to take it for us to be on our own 2 feet, we do need help. Because we have been here. We have been a good friend. If you want to make it a relationship type thing, we have been there. And now we deserve our payback. It's like you got a friend that you don't never look out for. This world is
so without using terms like individualism and Eurocentric and class warfare and like we're saying the same things. Saying the exact same things. So this is Tupac Shakur. When he was 17 years old, he's going to talk about class. He's going to talk about politics. He's going to talk about education. I'm only going to play the clip for like 2.5 minutes. This is a 17-year-old young man talking about everything that we could be talking about today. And I'm just going to let it play.
Well, the way that my mother brought me up is no lies, no, you know, total truth. Everything is real in society, you know. When you get out there, the responsibility is staggering. I mean, we're given a horrible world. We're given the gift that we're getting when we got to take over is horrible. They left us, they're leaving this world in bad shape for us to fix up. We're given no respect and we have to do a lot. I mean, the world, no secret, but the world is bad shape. So we have to do a lot. We have to do a lot of good things. So I think we deserve a little bit more respect.
And why do you think it is that adults don't give you the respect you deserve?
Fear. They're scared. The unsafe sex and drugs. You could tell if you look at the statistics, they're staggering again, you know. And so I think they're scared because they're realizing that they goofed. They really messed up. And children see things so great. If the world can, what happens is that adults complicate things, and facing each situation as it comes, and not dealing in a fairy tale land. Being realistic about the problem, but it's harder to see the bad things and everybody wants to shield the bad things and that's where it gets complicated and it gets real rotten. That's when everybody gets surprised and, oh my God, I'm committing suicide. That's too much, overwhelming. If you know about it, it won't be so overwhelming. My mother taught me 3 things, respect, knowledge, search for knowledge. It's an eternal journey. That's like my haircut, the line. 360 degrees, find knowledge, always. And she taught me to not be quiet. To, if there's something in my mind, speak it. School is, I think that we got so caught up in school being a tradition that we stopped using it as a learning tool, which it should be. Like, up to this day, I mean, school should be, I think there should be a different curriculum in each and every, like, neighborhood, you know? Because I'm going to Tamapai High and I'm learning about the basics, but they're not basic for me, you know? And it's like, they're not, to get us ready for today's world, they're not, that's not helping. It's just what they took, so it's what we're gonna take, you know? And that's why the streets have taught me. And but school is really important, reading, writing, arithmetic. But I think after you learn reading, writing, arithmetic, that's it. But what they tend to do is teach you reading, writing, arithmetic, then teach you reading and writing arithmetic again, then again, then again, just making it harder and harder, just so to keep you busy. And that's where I think they messed up. There should be a class on drugs. There should be a class on drugs. There should be a class on drugs. And there should be a drug class. There should be sex education. There should be a class on scams. There should be a class on religious cults. There should be a class on police brutality. There should be a class on apartheid. There should be a class on racism in America. There should be a class on why people are hungry, but they're not. Their class is on gym, you know, physical education. Let's learn volleyball. Actually, they should be teaching you English and then teaching you how to understand double talk, politicians double talk. We're not being taught to deal with the world as it is. We're being taught to deal with this fairyland, which we're not even living in anymore. And it's sad, because I'm telling you, and it should not be me telling you. It should be common knowledge. Aren't they wondering why death rates are going up and suicide is going up and drug abuse? Aren't they wondering? Don't they understand? I spent 8 years of my 17 years on this earth under Republicans, under Ronald Reagan, under an ex-actor who lies to the people, who steals money, and who's done nothing at all for me. And I don't think Bush is a bad person or a bad president, because for the upper class, he's a perfect president. And that's how society is built. The upper class run it while we talk about it. I mean, the middle class and lower class, we talk about it. And for the working class, we're just lost. We're going through the motions. We're the worker bees. And they get to live like royalty.
So from my studies of COINTELPRO and in, you know, infiltration, I would say that this was of paramount importance. Tupac talked about just his name being Shakur alone, you know, had him on a watch list from probably the day he was born. So the things that we see in the street today, they don't want to replicate this type of potential. They don't want anybody analyzing class and education and politics the way that this 17-year-old was doing. Because if a guy like this comes to a department like Temple University, we already know if Malcolm could come in contact with information in a prison cell and not even come in contact with the actual leadership and develop the type of ideology and potential within himself to transform himself and transform the world, they know how dangerous. That's why you see these critical race theory debates and you see people up in arms and having, you know, visceral physical responses to Black truth being taught throughout the nation, because I think it was Ashraf Kwesi, the master teacher, that said there's something about you that your enemy knows that you must not know about yourself. And Tupac seemed to be on to that. So in closing, this is the last video I'm going to play, and then I'll play one quote from Tupac, a little video quote. But I like the way that James Baldwin talked about, because he was another predictor, you know, of this fire, right? So this is the fire next time. 2022 is the fire. So people want to find out what's going on, and we want to trace it and look back. There was a lot of people saying, you know, cutting welfare. If you remember Bill Clinton with the welfare reform and the welfare queens, he was dragging these Black women up there, you know, for photo ops while they were cutting all the programs. And everybody in the street was saying, you keep closing down all the community centers. People had Boys and Girls Clubs. People go to YMCA. If you live, you know, in a place like I live, they don't have that anymore. They took the programs out of the schools and took the community programs out of the community. So a lot of times people try to complicate things. And I think if we tried to make that comparative analysis between the victimhood of some of the sexual abuses to some of the victimhood of some of the brutality, then we'll know how egregious it is to blame the victim. You got somebody with no services, no family structure, police attacking them and brutalizing them. Then they're being miseducated. They're looking in books with pottery and watercolors and all kind of things when it's their period of time. And then when they get to other people, they're showing faces. And not just faces, they're showing statues and Mount Rushmores and everything else. But you wondering why somebody's frustrated. No, the ancestors are speaking to them. The ancestors are saying this ain't right. So when you see them going out the side door or wanting to self-medicate or wanting to rebel and resist and be militant in classrooms and act out, they're responding to a divine assignment from the ancestors that has given them the inclination nation that this is not empowering them, this is not for them, this is psychological warfare, this is an attack on their purpose and potential and place as an African who designed to liberate and love African people. So oftentimes when you see somebody so-called acting bad, they're actually doing the right thing in a wrong system. Let me show you what James Baldwin said about this rage.
Baldwin, take one.
White people go around, it seems to me, with a very carefully suppressed terror. Black people have tremendous uneasiness. They don't know what the black face hides. And they're sure it's hiding something. What it's hiding is American history. You know, what it's hiding is what white people know they have done and are doing. You know, it's what, you know, white people know very well one thing, and it's the only thing they have to know. If they know this, everything else I say is a lie. They know they would not like to be black here. They know that. Now they know that. And they're telling me lies. They're telling me and my children nothing but lies.
For Baldwin, the truth is that the ghettos of his youth remain, gnawing at the spirit of those who live there.
The poverty is piled high, making it even more inescapable, and making it even more inescapable how thoroughly you're despised. The high-rise slum becomes a high-crime area almost at once, because what are you going to do with all these children, really, whole families, condemned forever to nothing in the richest city in the world? My best friend, a black boy, jumped off the George Washington Bridge when he was 24 and I was 22. And I was sure that I was going to be next.
Just from despair or?
From despair, from rage, you know. Because you can get to a place, you know, where you're in battle so often that that's all you can do. You know, you've been beaten so hard. All you can do your world narrows to a kind of red circle of rage.
Enter Tupac Shakur. What they say, when and where I enter, right? Enter Tupac Shakur. He said, I was happy. Right? These young people full of promise, full of hope. You saw him at 17. He was doing Raisin in the Sun on Broadway when they were helping the campaign for Jesse Jackson as president. He wasn't somebody that was just full of machismo and bravado. His mom, you know, taught him to respect women, and he had all these dreams of being a performer and an activist. And he was one of the best, you know, young New African Panthers in terms of selling papers and being a youthful leadership. He had all the potential and promise and optimism in the world. But when you start to violate people, and you leave them marked and scarred like this, it doesn't just last on their face, but it lasts on their hearts and in their spirit. Police are the biggest gang in America, and this is the last clip, and then we'll do Q&A.
Yes, my raps are filled with rage.
One of these days, we gotta bust back for the homies.
You have to be logical. You know, if I know that in this hotel room, they have food every day, and I'm knocking on the door every day to eat, and they open the door, let me see the party, let me see like them throwing salami all over the, I mean just like throwing food around, but they're telling me there's no food in here, you know what I'm saying? Every day, I'm standing outside trying to sing my way in, you know what I'm saying? We are hungry, please let us in, we are hungry, please let us in. After about a week, that song is gonna change to, we hungry, we need some food. After 2-3 weeks, it's like, you know, give me all the food, we're breaking out the door. And after a year, you just like, you know what I'm saying, I'm picking the lock, coming through the door, blasting, you know what I'm saying? It's like, you hungry, you reached your level, you don't want any more. We asked 10 years ago. We was asking with the Panthers. We was asking with them, you know, with civil rights movement. We was asking, you know. Now those people that were asking, they're all dead and in jail. So now what do you think we're gonna do? Ask?
So some would argue that it's the same song, you know, but some of the lyrics and melodies have changed. And a lot of people wonder how to solve the problem. But one thing that I think Tupac can help us all with is to be less confused about where we are and how we got here. So even as we begin this Q&A, I don't want it to be from a place of confusion, but a place of some sincere passion and the understanding of the importance of historical context so that we can really make progress and not fall into the rabbit hole of blaming each other and cross-generational sibling rivalry, but to really understand that there is a context that birthed what we see today. When I see them run into these convenience stores in the flash mobs, when I see the careless acts of violence, I think that Dr. King was talking about the language of the unheard, right? A riot was the language of the unheard, but imagine the unheard, the unseen, and the simultaneously violated and misrepresented and abandoned. So how does that manifest itself? If you just not being heard has you destroying and burning and looting in the 60s, then imagine when you get home, there's no father figure and the book, and then you got to deal with fentanyl and crack cocaine. So think about what Dr. King said and amplify that exponentially times 10, and you'll see what language is being spoken today, not just in the music, but in society. Thank you. It's been an honor, privilege, and a pleasure. I think I did 42 minutes, and I have a good 10 minutes for a Q&A or whatever Dr. Asante says is fitting.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Ade. As always, and as people have already been saying, this was phenomenal, but as always, you are able to bring the contemporary with the past, and also to show us that the past is still with us today. And Tupac is perhaps one of the greatest forces in connecting all of this together, and you have shown how he has done it from both a spiritual and an intellectual way. So we do have time for a few questions and a few answers. If there's anyone who would like to have a question, to give us a question, you can unmute yourself and start asking a question. All right, Sister Karen.
Yes, hi. Dr. Ade, I just want to thank you for addressing our real life issues and helping us to understand and make these connections that is so important, how we got to where we are today and unpacking this and dissecting this. How can our past be our present? And how do we begin to turn this around for ourselves? If we don't have the necessary conversations, nothing will be done. So I just wanted to thank you for bringing it to the forefront, and you did a wonderful job. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think it's a song, Changes by Tupac, in between the verses where he's talking and he says, let's change the way we eat, let's change the way we live, let's change the way we treat each other, because the old way wasn't working. Now it's time for us to do what we got to do to survive, right? And I always think to myself, that was my whole curriculum. Let's change the way we eat, let's change the way we live, let's change the way we treat each other, right? They always wonder how I, you know, get these innovative and you know, unorthodox approaches. And I'm saying, no, Tupac was saying we need to talk about racism in America, we need to talk about apartheid. So when they come to a Tupac class and they hear about these subjects, they don't know Tupac well enough to know that Tupac already wrote this curriculum long ago. And I think it's really important to be able to operationalize these lifestyles. Because for those that don't know, Tupac Shakur, after the Mike Tyson fight, the MGM Grand, got into a dispute with Orlando Anderson, a known gang member who was under investigation for multiple murders, got into a physical confrontation with Orlando Anderson, and 2 hours or less later was killed on the Vegas Strip. So when I talked about Will Smith, not just the connections in terms of childhood and interaction, I'm saying to champion losing your cool is to lack an understanding about how other people losing their cool contributed to them losing their lives. Tupac died because he did something just like what Will Smith did. He couldn't keep his hands to himself. He couldn't control and discipline himself. Like, it's interesting because one of the elders was talking to me about, he was talking about, I think it might be Proverbs, right? He's talking Book of Proverbs, talking about being wise and keeping your peace, 29:11. And he was saying, you know, wise people don't say everything right away. They don't pour out everything on their heart and say everything on their mind, because when you're wise, you wait for the right time. And I was thinking, no, it's not just keeping your peace in terms of your silence. It's keeping your peace in terms of the notion of sanity and stability and balance, that type of peace, right? So when you hear keep your peace, you're not keeping your mouth shut to be passive. You're not keeping your mouth shut just to prove that you're wise. You're keeping your mouth shut so your days can be long, you have an abundant life, and you can stay alive. So I think sometimes people can connect their discipline to their actual life expectancy and quality of life. Tupac, that the lesson must not have been learned, because people all over social media, oh, that's so good. He jumped up for his woman and smacked him, and he was defending her. No. People who love Tupac said, no, that's how you get killed. That's how we lose you. You lose your temper and we lose you, and your family loses you and your community loses you, and nobody benefits from your potential. And these young brothers in particular today need to understand that some of the greatest displays of strength is in disciplining yourself enough to control yourself in situations that might inspire your aggression.
Mm-hmm. All right. That's okay. Hand up. I'm sorry. Yes. Go right ahead. Sister Alexandra. That's true. Unmute yourself, Eldred. Just hit.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Dr. Jabali. I'm not pronouncing it right, but I'm glad to see you. I want to know the correct spelling of your name, Dr. Smith. I got to tell all the girls I got a chance to see you again. Got the new name, and hope to contact you sometime during the year to come back to us.
Just let me know, J-A-B-A-L-I.
Okay.
Ade is A-D-E. My son's name is Bakari Ade.
Okay.
And I know that was one of the potential names that the doc had sent out to me. I said that must be the ancestors connecting us, because I think that's a beautiful thing that I can share a name with my son through my consciousness and not from my ego trying to name him my name.
That's true.
No offense to the juniors out there or the seniors.
That's right. Well, Dr. Ade, I was a junior, and I was fortunate enough that my father said, I wish I had known an African name when you were born. I would have given you an African name. So he was very happy that I had an African name.
I'm following him on this one. I'm following my son.
There you go.
Second Ade.
All right, we have time for one or two more questions. There's a hand that's being raised. Let's see, who is this?
I see Zipporah.
Zipporah, go right ahead. There, okay. Zipporah, are you there? Unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. Hi, Dr. Smith. How are you?
Doing well. Greetings.
Good to see you again. Are you still going to be on WRD?
Not regularly, but maybe one day as a guest.
Oh, one day as a guest. All right. So you're not doing the regular programming anymore.
No. And to speak to that, I was listening to a speech by Tupac, and he was talking about how once he got on record is when he had a record. He didn't have a criminal record until he started to make records, until he started to be visible. And oftentimes, I don't think we properly prepare the young people for what comes with the mantle of their anointing. If you are somebody who is a speaker, right? If you're somebody who's been given a gift to convey ideas, I think you need to understand that within the context of the global system of white supremacy and infiltration and oppression, because the higher up I was going, and Doc knows, it's a lot of things that just start happening that wasn't happening any other time before. I've been at Temple for 30 years, and the time I was on WRD and, you know, having a bigger name, the attacks are plenty. And I had to feel, I had to realize within myself, how do I best serve my people over time, not in the moment? And how do I serve my people and not serve my ego? And a lot of times people need to make this connection between invisibility and your potential to have invincibility, because your legacy lives longer than you. So for me to, you know, lay low for a couple of years, write books that'll last but beyond the grave, and get tenure and secure my job, I can actually do more for my people if I just take myself out the equation and say it's not all about me, and have a longer protracted strategy as opposed to just wanting to be seen or wanting to be known or moving impulsively, similar to what I said about the physical impulse, you know, to jump out the window, as they say. You also have to have an academic maturity to not just write everything, say everything, and learn how to strategize so that you can have the most long-term, impactful, transformative, you know, potential for the liberation of your people over time and even beyond, you know, when you're here. So just because you're sowing a seed and planting a seed don't mean you're supposed to be the one watering or give an increase or be around when it blossoms and blooms. So I understood that taking a step back sometimes is the best way to step forward.
Okay, wonderful. Right. That's wonderful. I really appreciate that answer, because when we are raised up high, that the first people to see us are our enemies. So it's always good to be wise in the way we present ourselves. Okay, I think that's the last question.
I have a quick question, if I can. Yes. I just would like to know if your presentation on Tupac is actually accessible. I've been trying to have these little sessions with my grandchildren. We're all in different states. And just as a quick example, I asked one of them, he was 13, I asked him, what do you know about the Black Panther Party? And of course it was all negative. So, you know, I had to pull out the 10 things, you know, and say, you know, how does this balance with what you've heard? And so my thing is, I know what they're not gonna get in school. I know what I would like to teach them, but I also wanna, you know, handle stuff that's sort of age appropriate and also that will capture their interest. And surely Tupac is part of that. So I guess that's one thing I want to know, is that available on YouTube? Or
it will be available on YouTube by tomorrow. This is, we have the Maleficate Asante Institute Lectures. And if you go to the Maleficate Asante Institute Lectures, you will see this video tomorrow. And we are planning our next program will be on June 12th at 4 p.m. And by that time, we may have our own YouTube channel. But if we do not, you will get a message that will give you the Zoom number again. And we'll do Zoom. We're hoping sometime in June to have a physical opening of our building. But even then, we will still be broadcasting at 4 p.m. From the Maleficate Asante Institute. So we're really thankful for all of you who are, you know, keeping up with us and sharing with us. We appreciate you so much. You are just really a blessing. And thank you. I really, I just even see Professor Dandridge just showed up. So all wonderful people, good people trying to do the best for our community. You guys are great. And we want to thank those from South Africa and also from Europe who have also been with us today.
And I put it in the chat, Doc. I put the Malefic Kedisanti Institute, and I put a link for the YouTube.
All right, wonderful.
And thank just you, in terms of what the last question referred to, there's actually something called the Thug Life Code, where Tupac was inspired by the 10-point program of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. And I always tell my students, I always say the full name because I want them to know why this organization was formed in the first place. So I think one of the linguistic tricks and devices was to say the Black Panther Party. They always leave off the for self-defense because that puts the
onus on
reality. But there's a 10-point program for the Black Panthers, but Tupac, inspired by that, created something called the Thug Life Code, where he tried to politicize the gangs and worked in communication with Matula Shakur to build out this code, because Matula was asking him, what does this thug life mean? It has to have some structure and a purpose. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a good on-ramp to have these kind of conversations cross-generationally as well. And I think it's also extremely important to make sure that we support institutions like the Malefic Kedisanti Institute, because I always hear people say how much they enjoy being at the Institute, how much they benefit from the information. So I always tell people, part of what we need to do to move from being rhetoricians to institution builders is to support our institutions. There are people I know that give more to a strip club and Chick-fil-A than they do to Afrocentric organizations. We cannot continue to do that. You can't be less sophisticated than your enemy and expect liberation. So, you know, I'm not the one always telling people to donate, but when you see something that works and is going right, at least for you and the people that you know and care about and giving you information that can help you and your people and your community, then continue, please, to support the Malefic Kedisanti Institute at any opportunity you can.
Thank you very much. I want to say, we appreciate Dr. Ade for a very powerful presentation, and we appreciate all of you, and want to reach out to Olutoyosi also, who is our tech person, and thank her very much for all support. See you guys later. Hotel.
Hey, Dr. Sante.
Yes.
I was supposed to get with you, we haven't yet, for that book on Herodotus on Egypt.
Okay, yes. You have my phone number, right?
No, I don't.
Okay, let me give you my phone number.
Okay.
215-620-5542. And that way you can call me and I will find a copy for you, or find a PDF copy for you from my computer. All
okay.
right.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.